call in number. Hopefully, if any people are online, I expect some of you will lose television.
Ecstatic.
Well, let us begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good gracious God, we thank you for the blessings you give to us in our lives, especially the gift of our faith. We pray that you be with our nation today, election, whatever happens, there comes to be violence or disruptions. Help us all to be the best Christians that we can be. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Amen. In the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Father Ray, can you repeat what you said at the beginning? Because it wasn't broadcasting your voice. Just that we're trying to get the.
Oh, okay. If you're online, we don't have a video, but we do have audio. So we do have something on the way to try to fix it. And so.
Now it's your video capture.
Technology is great. When it works. At any rate. All right. Well, tonight we're talking about God. You may think that's a pretty basic thing. Of course, that's what we're here for. We're talking about God. And so the thing about God is that God is kind of the.
Sure.
I'll be honest, God is the key of all that we're here for.
I don't know, okay? There's something.
But the thing about God is
to see your video.
We can't see God. People saw Jesus, but we can't see God because we experience God. So if you can tell me any ways that we have experienced God.
This one is awesome. Can you do the video capture, guys?
I can only imagine, I can only imagine that when you hold that child in your arm, what are some other ways that we experience God? Yeah, anytime you look at creation, except for the ice storm, tears it all down. Anytime you look at creation, all of it is human life. But I think if we analyze, probably all have times in our lives when we have actually experienced in a very special way. I remember in my life, there's been many, but one of the first ones that I remember was when I was a young priest, and I was at St. Charles, and a man called on the phone late at night, and and so I was like, well, I've been teaching this in seminary, I don't know really what to do. But I talked to the guy, and so finally, he said, I can't do that. And so I don't think it was my persuasion that caused him not to do it. I think that was God. Another time that I really remember feeling God's presence is there again when I was a student in Rome, and I had the privilege to go and meet Pope John Paul, and that was an awesome experience. Obviously now he's a saint, but just meeting him was an awesome experience where I truly felt, I truly felt in meeting him that I was, in the presence of God. So, I think if we look at our lives, there's times in all of our lives when we do have those experiences of God. Another one that I probably really remember the most is when the Archbishop sent me to Italy to go to school.
It doesn't seem to be.
I arrived there, something's not. And I realized once the plane landed, first, it seemed like a really cool thing. Ooh, I'm going to Italy, vacation, Sophia Loren, and all that kind of stuff, But once I landed in Rome and I got off the plane, I realized I don't speak a language, and I do not know one single person on the European continent. And so Well, the reality is, I mean, I have never felt so alone and abandoned in my life. And I thought to myself, I did not sign off. And at any rate, long story short, I powered through it, and it turned out to be probably one of the best experiences of my life. So I think if we look at life, we probably all have those experiences.
Machine that can.
Taught us that we can either turn away from God we can depend on God more than ever. I think, you know, we've had to do that. The other thing we talk about with God is that the Lord is merciful. Because if we think about in the Exodus, and the Exodus was when Moses led the people through the desert from slavery and freedom. And in that time, there were times when the people were going along with their lives and then they turned away from God. Okay, so that would be like when they made the golden calf, when they, you know, did all these different things. And every time the people turned away from God, what would happen in the Exodus? You know, remember? Yes. They would die or like bad stuff would happen, okay? So then when they would turn back to God, then things would get better. And so the thing about, you remember the golden calf? When people turned away from God to worship the golden calf, and Moses prays to God, please, God, forgive these people for worshiping the golden calf. And he did. And because Moses said the first time, because you have to remember, in those times, people were terrified of God. They were afraid, you know, if you made God mad, that something horrible was going to happen. And so Moses said, the Lord is a forgiving God. And so that was one of the first things that happened that was different for people, is to realize that the Lord is merciful. Okay? So he's not a God that's up there like, you know, telling you to mark down all of your sin, but he is a God who is merciful, loving, and different. That was kind of the case for Moses. That was a new thing for today. And even to this day, I mean, I think we probably all have experienced God today, and that's okay. We will continue to do that throughout our lives. The other thing, God is truth. He's all love. And you know, the Lord is God is just something that is beyond human understanding. So even St. Paul says, the peace of God comes beyond all human understanding, comes to your hearts and minds. The reality is of life, because God is so complex, will never. Know about God, or we wouldn't be here. Okay? So then God reveals himself, obviously, Jesus, the Son. But God also reveals himself in what we call the Trinity. And what is the Trinity? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Trinity is a pretty complicated thing to try to. I'll never forget several years ago after a Sunday mass, a young person came up to me and they said, Father, can I ask you a question? I said, well, sure, of course you can. I thought it would be something quite simple, like, why do you wear that color or that, or, you know, why do we sing this hymn or that hymn? Yeah, this young kid, probably third or fourth grade, said, can you explain the Trinity? And I'm like, and every year when I do the interviews for the kids who are getting confirmed in high school, I always ask them, is there one thing that you still don't really completely understand? And they always say, the Trinity. And so, many years ago, a priest told me to look at the Trinity like this, with crying. And so, you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay? All think about it, think about the Trinity as a relationship. He said you have an I, then the us. Okay? So look at it as the I and the you and the us. So think about the Trinity. Think about just us, a few of us here tonight. Okay? There's each of us individually, then there's you guys, but then we're together, what are we? That's right, we're a whole unit, okay? And the thing that binds us together while we're here could be like the Holy Spirit, okay? So, Holy Spirit is what brought us here. Holy Spirit is what binds us together as people of faith. So, the Trinity is really all about relationship. You, me, and us. So, think about it. You have God the Father, Jesus the Son, and then the thing that binds them together, other than the paternal relationship, is the Holy Spirit. And so, that is kind of, in some ways, think about the Trinity. Now, first of all, we have God the Father, and then obviously Jesus was the Son. And God is the Father. Jesus is also the Father of all things. He's the creator of all things. And he revealed himself in his Son. And part of Jesus is in all of us. Because we are made in the image and the likeness of God. Okay? And so, also, we are a part of what we call the body of Christ. So Jesus and God are in all of us. So I think sometimes with God, we can kind of overthink it and try to analyze, you know, what is God, how is he revealing himself to us, all of these different things. But like I said at the beginning, if we think of God and those times in our lives and things that happen to him, we felt God's presence, you know, here's another example. Today, I got called to give someone the last rites because they were probably not out of COVID, and so when I went into the room, you know, it was pretty intense. But we started talking about it. So the person said, you know, Father, I'm not afraid of God because I know that God is going to take care of me. And so I think now that's a tragic thing, you know, to think of something God's presence. But then there's also been any good thing, like someone said, she'll language. Just even things that happen in our lives. One of the things that I maintain is that, you know, people, God puts people in our lives when they need to be. Okay? And yeah, we can try to explain it away, but I think sometimes, you know, we see God and experience God, we don't even really realize what is going on. Now, with Jesus, he announced was God, that he was going to send the Spirit down, okay? And the Holy Spirit is another thing that's pretty difficult to explain, but the reality is that the Spirit causes us to act, okay? So, for example, in the, how many of you lost power? So when you're sitting there in the dark and you don't have any power and you're kind of disconnected from the world, it's kind of a feeling of that. What? Loneliness. That's right. Darkness. Okay? Like, I never lost power, per se, if I've lost cable and internet. And so that was, you know, kind of shallow, but, you know, there wasn't a feeling of being disconnected from Well, that's what we have to think about, you know, we're never disconnected from the war. In fact, the reading, the second reading for Mass of the Sunday says, you know, all things we can hope that you're never alone with the Lord and the Holy Spirit and Jesus. And so, when Jesus sent out the disciples, he said, go out and baptize in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He said that the Trinitarian order. And so, everything we do, every time we pray as Catholics, what do we do? What's the first thing we do? That we make the sign of the cross, okay? And so, we call upon the Trinity to answer our prayers. And so, if you think about it, though, divine persons. They're very distinct. You have God the Father, Jesus the Son. Now, God the Father, obviously, we haven't seen here. Jesus the Son, and there are people in the world, not this life, but maybe before us, have seen and witnessed. I would encourage all of you who ever get the chance to be able to travel down. Go to the Holy Land, because the Holy Land is a game. I mean, I say that kind of weirdly. Like the first time, I was like invited to go to the Holy Land, and I was like, I don't go there because one, there's always violence. Or two, I don't have good wine. You know, I mean, it's shallow, stupid reasons. I'd rather go to Europe. Well, the first time I went to the Holy Land was probably about 5 years ago. It was a game changer, because seeing the places where our Lord was born, where he was laid in the tomb, and where he ministered, it just opens your eyes in ways that you never have. There came another reality of life. Most people don't get that luxury, they don't get that opportunity to get to go to the Holy Land. But I'm telling you, if you ever get that, it is awesome. And we have to think, another thing you have to remember about God and Trinity and things like that is that it's a mystery. And St. Thomas said that God is studying his faith. Well, I mean, if we know that God is beyond all human understanding, we'll never completely understand the whole concept of God, how he exists. One of the problems in modern society, which is very sad, is that the reality is that the world has become very sad. When I say secular, what am I talking about? Yeah, agnostic or not really into God and all of that. And I think at the end of the day, I mean, that's not a good thing, but it is what it is. And we can't control the world, we can only control what's in our own life. And that's why I would tell people, you know, don't try to overthink things like the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, because when you try to overthink it, that's when it makes it all the more difficult to try to understand. And I've been a priest 30 years, I've been a Catholic for, been a Catholic 43 years, been a Christian all my life. And I can safely say that even I don't completely understand 100% about the notion of God, Trinity, all of that. But I take it on faith because I have just seen the proof of God's work. I'll give you another example. How many of you have ever been stressed out? We're all stressed. Right now, especially. Okay? I mean, everybody's. Well, I've been really stressed out about something. shouldn't be kind of a, an answer on how to fix this. So, and finally today, didn't come to me, but I was talking to someone else about it. They said, well, why don't you do this? And I was like, well, I never thought of doing that. And so I did it, and it amazingly, I get confused with the situation and made it seem a lot less stressful. So I think with God, if we're open to, you know, how we might respond in our lives, we will be surprised at how that all works. But we have to remember, and that's probably one of the most confusing things, that the Trinity, they are three distinct persons, but yet they're one together. And like I say, I wouldn't get all theological and try to get into, you know, to mystic theology or kind of guessing and all that. I just think that thinking of God, the Trinity, as that triangle of relationship thing is really kind of the easiest way to think about it. And like I said, if you try to overthink it, we're going to make it more hard. So that's just the way it is. Do you have any questions? Okay. Guys, do you have any questions? Are we good now?
Yep.
All right. And so, kind of the next thing that we, you know, God was the creator of all things. Okay. Now, here's the thing that sometimes gets people kind of riled up. I remember the first time I heard it, I was taken aback, upset, shocked. Is that, you know, the world was created by God. That we know, we believe. Now, was it exactly as it was in the book of Genesis, where it was exactly 7 days? You know, that we don't know for sure. I mean, not that the Bible is not correct or anything like that. You have to remember what especially the Old Testament was written. People, human beings, are trying to explain how the world came into being. Okay? And so what we believe is that however the world came into being, however creation happened, is that God was the impetus behind it. And then, you know, years ago, there was that whole thing, you know, Galileo, the church denounced him and Darwin and all of that. Well, as time has gone on, we've realized that, you know, look, however we believe the world came to be, we one, only God can create something out of that. And so, it may have happened in the 7 days, but you have to remember, at the time of the Old Testament, time was measured in a very different way. It wasn't 24-hour days like we have now. And so 7 days could have been 7 centuries, something like that. And so just because you say we don't know 100% exactly, it happens exactly like you say, it doesn't mean that God didn't have a part of it because we believe that God did. So creationism, all those things, I mean, they're not incongruent with. However the world came to be, God created. And there again, you know, it says in the Bible, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and all things were made through Him. Without Him was not anything that was made. And so, God created the world. God created all that we have. God created many good things. Did God create bad things? Or did bad things? That's a centuries old question, you know. Was humanity born good and then corrupted by society, or were people born corrupt and then God made them good? Well, I think we have to go back to, you know, Adam and Eve. So God created maybe to start, and all this and that. And then there was Adam and Eve, and he told them, he said, what did he say? Don't eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge. And like any good kid, like when we were kids and our parents said, don't do that, what do we immediately do? We do it, right? So, you know, like, whole mask. Now that's become a huge big deal. People want to fight and argue about it. And one person told me, I said, well, I would wear a mask if they didn't tell me I had. And so, you know how people are. People tell us we have to do something, or we should do this. Human nature is we're going to, part of us that wants to do the opposite. So, commit to sin, we have to have three things. You have to have full knowledge, consent of the will, and great wrath. And what that means is, when we commit a sin, we have to know what we're doing, know that it's wrong, and we choose to do it. So when Adam and Eve come out and they ate the apple of the fruit of the tree of knowledge, then what happened? Then they knew what was a sin. They knew what was wrong. So that's what happened. And so, you know, that's like I said, the question that's been asked at the beginning of time is, was humanity born good and corrupted by society, or was humanity born bad and made better by society? I think, probably if you look at the world nowadays, you're probably born good, but you kind of get corrupted. And that's where it's real easy to kind of lose faith. We have to be careful about that. Because, you know, we see all this bad stuff happening in the world, and we say, why did God let this happen? It's literally saying, why did God let the pandemic happen? Okay? Well, I don't believe God let the pandemic happen. I mean, there have been times, like I said, since the beginning of time, since Adam and Eve, where people have been subverting the will of God. And so, you know, I don't know where the pandemic all started and all of that, but I know we've had them before, and we'll probably have them again. And because of free will of human beings, God gave us free will, things have happened. Did God want Adolf Hitler to eradicate Jewish race? No, absolutely not, because Jesus was Jewish. But yet, you know, through the free will of Adolf Hitler and others, they decided that was what they were going to do. But I do believe for all of us in our lives that God has a plan, and that's what we call divine providence. And one of the things where I see that most is oftentimes when I do weddings. So many times when I do weddings, I see couples. And every now and then you'll have one, you're like, oh, this is the roll of the dice. I don't know if this is going to make it or not. But a lot of times when I see weddings and I'm thinking, you know, you have two people from totally different parts of their life, parts of the world, and they somehow meet up and they come together. And is that just mere coincidence? I don't know. I don't think so. It's more so than that. And even for like the calling to be a priest, I mean, that was not an easy thing to decide. But I think God put people into my life and put things into my head that made me want to do it. I'll give you an example. I always kind of thought about being a priest, but I wasn't a Catholic. You know, I grew up, I was just an alien. In high school, I became Catholic, and the thought of being a priest was still there. Obviously, like a normal guy, I wanted to get married, I wanted to make money, I wanted to have kids, and all that kind of stuff. But that thought never really went away. So I was on a business trip. I was an accountant before I became a priest. I was on a business trip in St. Louis, Missouri. And if you've never been to St. Louis, they have beautiful one down by the river is nice, but the big one is further to the west, and it has, it's probably one of the largest cathedrals in the country, it has the largest collection of mosaics. Anyway, long story short, I said, well, I'm going to visit this cathedral. So I went to visit this cathedral, it was on a Saturday night, and it was like, oh, they'll have mass. And so I decided to stay for mass. Well, it was an ordination, and I had never been to an ordination in my life. And so I went in, went to that ordination, and I felt really the Holy Spirit. I mean, I like broke out in sweat. You know, I remember I came home and I told my family, and they're like, hey, counseling, you know, and all of that. So then that happened, and then I'm not exaggerating, literally, 3 months later, the same thing happened here. I was driving down Western Avenue on a Saturday afternoon, and I got this kind of thought, well, I need to go to Mass at Our Lady's Cathedral, and I went to Mass, and in fact, gosh, early 80s, you know, I went to Mass, and it happened to be the ordination of Father Bill Pruitt, who's a friend of mine, and Father Joe Boss, who passed away. But I found out later on, for both of those occasions, it was the first and only time they have ever had ordination mass during a regularly scheduled mass. Because the ordination lasts about 2.5 hours. And can you imagine if I threw something like that in here at 10 o'clock in the morning, put that back for you, you'd fly on the wall. Okay? So, you know, I thought, okay, that's a sign. So I went to the seminary. I thought, well, I'm just going to test this thing out, get it out of my system, and then I'll move on down the road. Well, here I am, you know, 30 years later. So God and the Spirit do work in different ways. And that's kind of the second part of what we're going to talk about, is the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, there again, that's, when did the Holy Spirit come down? When did God send down the people to God? Pentecost, that's right. He sent down the Holy Spirit upon the apostles, okay? And he said, you know, receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, go out and be baptized in the name of the Father and the Holy Spirit. There again, the Holy Spirit is what, you know, helps us to decide what to do, helps inform our conscience. And so, you know, the Holy Spirit has names like the Advocate, the Paraclete, okay? But then there's symbols of the Holy Spirit. Well, the biggest symbol of the Holy Spirit is water. Because when we're baptized with water, okay? I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Also, anointing. Anointing with the holy oil, that is the way that the blessings of the Holy Spirit. So, for example, when a baby is baptized, we bless them with the holy oil that's been blessed by the bishop. The chrism oil, which is the same oil that's used for confirmation and for ordaining priests, we bless them with that. And we say, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and then we do the same thing again. The other thing that was always a symbol of the Holy Spirit was fire, you know, because in the Bible it says, you know, the Holy Spirit descended upon the apostles in tongues of fire. Another symbol of the Holy Spirit was a dove. You know, if we look back early Genesis, a dove was released by Noah, and then came back to the olive branch. Now, when we receive the Holy Spirit through baptism, we receive what are called the gifts and the fruits of the Holy Spirit. So, I get asked. Guys, they remember the gift. I will do that. All right. judgment against the fruits of the Spirit.
Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness.
Joy?
Joy.
Same thing.
So, kind of difficult to remember Paul. So, you get what are called seven gifts of the Holy Spirit. And they're, I will write them down. The things that you use.
Well, not joy.
So, gifts of the Holy Spirit. Seven. The first one is wisdom. The second one is understanding. Remind you, counsel. Who is it? No. Piety and fear of the Lord. Okay, so these are gifts of the Holy Spirit, the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit. You receive the baptism and confirmation. So wisdom, that gives us, I guess, doesn't mean we're all wise people, you know, we are, but doesn't mean we're like necessarily intellectually gifted. But what it means is we're given the wisdom to understand the faith, the things that we need to understand about life. So wisdom is not what's right. Understanding, that means that we try to understand things to the best of our ability. But also, we are understanding when somebody needs us here. So you guys all know that we've all had to, you know, consult people that were stressed out or sad or something like that. And so understanding helps us to be understanding when people need that, like God is understanding for us. Counsel. That doesn't mean we're all counselors. But that means that, you know, through the gift of the Holy Spirit, we can, you know, maybe give good advice to people or help them to know what is right and what is wrong and what is the best thing to do. Fortitude. That is something that we need on a daily basis. What is fortitude? Strength to get sicker. What do we need right now in 2020? Fortitude, okay? If you're still without power, we need a lot of fortitude, okay? The pandemic, we need fortitude. You know, all of this stuff we need, okay? Because it lets us keep going when things seem like they're not going. Knowledge. That means that, you know, we have knowledge of God, we have knowledge of Jesus, we have knowledge of faith. We understand that. But we have that knowledge. We have to learn it. It's not, we get that with the Holy Spirit, but it then just osmose. So, I mean, we have to, like you're doing now, you're in class, you read, you study. We have to constantly feed that knowledge. It's like going to school. Piety, that's the gift of prayer. You know, piety means, you know, we pray, we hear the sacraments, we do all what, you know, fear of the Lord sounds kind of over the top, scary, but let's face it. I mean, when we're a kid, we love our parents, but aren't we, in some ways, through respect, a little fearful of them? How are we feeling fearful of our parents? How? Yeah. Well, that's a good one. Yes, they know more than we do, but we don't want to let them know. And one of the things you learn as you get older is that the younger you get, the smarter your parents. You know, when you're young, your the same thing with God. But also, we have a respectful fear that we know that if we unsnap this point or do something wrong with our parents, what's going to happen? There's some kind of punishment, there's going to be some kind of reparation. Now, you know, I don't know necessarily if you think God punishes people, so that, I mean, you have to be careful. That doesn't mean like somebody's cancer or they get a car wreck or something like that. God is punishing them, okay? No, I mean, sometimes just things happen. But I do think that God does punish us in one way, because usually when we do something wrong, what happens? What goes on in here? What bothers us? Your conscience bothers, okay? So you and I both, like, we do something wrong, our conscience. So then, it's like Brandon Reed was saying, then we have the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Now, these are ones that are much more kind of tangible and conceivable. Okay? So those are things like charity, joy, peace. All things that we would desperately need, but we also should be trying to use in our daily life. Charity, okay? That means that we are charitable in our thoughts, charitable in our actions, charitable in, like, sharing and giving the things. Joy, you know, that means that we're happy about our faith and our lives. You know, trying to do the best that we can. But we all know that will be needed sometimes, because sometimes we get sad, we get depressed, we get overwhelmed, we cry, and things happen. But someone told me the other day, which at first I was just like, you're nuts. Someone told me the other day, they said, 2020 has been the best year of my life, here's the world. And I'm like, wow, you're crazy. And they were like, no, because you realize that at the end of the day, there's so much that I really don't have control over, but that Jesus is still Lord and Jesus is still Christ. I hadn't thought about it that way. So, you know, that would be like, well, peace. You know, we all want to be peacemakers, but sometimes we all get involved in arguments or fights or things like that. I mean, conflict is just a part of life. But there's peace. I was waiting in a 2-hour line to vote today. I can tell you, all of us in line, our patience was really very thin. And I go here at the church, and I, you know, I'm at the church, I can't vote because that would not be fair. And that's a civil thing. I can't do that. But we were sitting out there literally for 45 minutes, and nobody was going in. And so patience was very. So they all looked at me, even though I'm a priest here, and they were all starting to grab me, and I said, hey, I'm not in charge of the election board. So my patience is great. So I went inside and asked kind of what was going on, and the guy could not explain that what they were doing is they had the whole inside full of people, and they were going to let them all vote before they let the next group in. So once we heard that, you know, it's delivered. Plus, we all get impatient. You know, if you're at the stop sign and the car in front of you is not going because of texting or messing around or something, what are you going to do? You're going to get impatient. Get impatient with those who love. Kindness. The Lord of the world needs kindness. He that's the one thing that worries me about, about the world in which we live now is that, one of my best friends is an agnostic, and, we are at opposite ends on every single thing, politically, religiously, everything. But yet, we have been friends since college, and we talked about the election. I said, look, there is no point in us even going, okay? We've been friends too long, we know we're not going to agree, so that's fine. But now, there's somebody, especially if you look at social media, somebody disagrees with you, you have to attack your idea. First, a horrible person, that's not what we need, okay? Goodness. We all struggle to do good, but it's not always easy. And then, guys, remember these scripts and gifts of the Holy Spirit we have? That doesn't mean we always use them, okay? We use them to our ability. But we have them in there because we can. Generosity. The Lord has given us blessings. Yeah, there's always going to be those who have more, maybe those who have less. But we should be able to share not just our material things, but even our time. Okay? And sometimes it's hard. My mother is 90 years old, and she lost her power, and trying to deal with all this and the pandemic. My life is pretty busy. And so, finally, I was just getting so frustrated and calling on. So I thought, look, I've been in the care of Ryan. I don't know why I didn't see that he brought up in my way, but she was like thanking me. And I said, well, mother, you drove me around and took care of me when I was a kid. So, time to do that now. One of the things that's a big problem, even in relationships and marriage now, is people not being faithful. The number one problem in marriage now, anyone guess what that might be? Social media. And one of the things that's happening is cyber affairs. I work in a marriage tribunal with our guys, which handles all the hormones. So I see it. People have convinced themselves that, I might be having a chat with someone in Pittsburgh, that person, so I'm not being faithful, but then I might be emotionally, okay? Modest, what that is. Don't be a big blowhard, brag about stuff, or dress in a modest way, I had a wedding a couple weeks ago, and some of the lady got up to read, and I was just like, please don't let her bow. Because the whole world did it. It was just like modesty, definitely modesty. Self-control, that's a tough one too. When we feel like that pressure to blow up about something, or have that, fourth piece of chocolate cake, third glass of scotch, or something like that, we have to say, hey, we need to control that, keep that down. And chastity is obviously, we live in a very sexual world, but we have to keep, our minds and our hearts and our thoughts chaste to the best of our ability. Because, if we're not, if we're all Christians, all people are called to chastity. And that means, we don't. Outside of there. So those are kind of the gifts and the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And so really the Holy Spirit is that part of the Trinity which aligns us with God and Jesus, also causes us to act. And we have to believe that in some way, shape, or form, it was the Holy Spirit who brought you here to RCIA. Okay? If you could have been doing anything. The Holy Spirit can grab you here tonight. Obviously, the Holy Spirit doesn't work on a bunch of other people. You understand all that stuff, you're very nice. But, You know, if we continue, just because we have these gifts and traits, that means we all use them, if we're there for it. Anybody have any questions? The online people ask questions?
They can't, we don't have, we didn't access, like, we can't access them for questions.
Okay.
We're not that fancy.
Alright. That's kind of really, you know, I always found that these topics, most people in here already have some sort of relationship with God, the Holy Spirit, so, you know, we're overboard on it all. But I would just say, you know, be thankful for the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Don't try to overanalyze faith or God. That's who we are. Overanalyze it. Try to explain it. I know a lot of people are anxious to get home, watch the thing, but I'm not going to watch that. I don't know what that is. You know, you got to talk to me about it and find out about it. All right, well, let's close it. We're going to have the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Mighty God, indeed, we get to faith, we get to time together. Pray that you may continue to bless us with all that we say. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Next week, we get to hear me again, and we're going to talk about we'll have it for next week. The church. We start with the church. One holy Catholic. All right, thank you guys so much.